Good morning, and welcome to the morning service from the Wyndham Church of the Nazarene. We're so glad that you joined us today. Hope you had a great week. Before we started, I know my husband wished Carol and Dawn Hall a happy anniversary on his Devo yesterday, but today is the actual day, so we just want to say happy anniversary to Dawn and Carol, and hope you have a really nice day today. Hope that you guys have had a good week and you came ready to praise the Lord. I know it's probably strange sitting there and singing to each other in your living rooms or kitchens or dining rooms, wherever you are, but don't hesitate to sing the praises of God this morning. Join us, will you? And this is something we've all been doing, leaning on the everlasting arms.
He is alive. I'm going to sing has a lot to do with wherever we're standing. Whatever path or whatever place God has us, this next song is paramount to being able to stand there and hear His voice and do as He would lead us to do and not get caught up in what the world may be saying and what we may think needs to happen. But today I challenge us all, before we go into a sermon, to ask the Lord to change our hearts. And it's always a good thing. It doesn't have to be over something that's negative. It's a positive thing when we ask the Lord to change our hearts. We want to become more and more like Him all the time. So as we sing this today, I want you to reflect on the week, on where we've been and the things we've gone through as a society, as a state, as a town, and right down to the heart of it as individuals. Can we say today that we are asking God to change our hearts? It's a wonderful thing to be independent, but our independence needs to be through Him and through who He would have us to be. So this morning as we go to prayer, I would once again challenge all of us to allow God to change our hearts and our minds to what He knows we need to have in both of them, as He has us standing where He has us standing. I would like to mention today that we lost our sister, Charlene Scammon. Charlene passed away a couple days ago, and she'd been sick for a season, and we hadn't seen her, I think, since last July or June. And we really, really grew to love Charlene. She'd been with us 3 or 4 years, and of course, I grew up with her on Brighton Avenue Church in Portland. And so we have lost one of our sisters here on earth, but she's gained glory And as I said to somebody, she's miles and light years ahead of us, and she's seeing things that I can't wait to see. I can't wait to see all my family and loved ones. And she had a brother, Billy, up there, so she's reunited with them. And, so remember the Scanlon family in your prayers. And also I'd like to pray for our children. The Lord put it on my heart today to lift up our kiddos that go to church here. This is a great dynamic change in their lives, too. You know, a lot of times we focus so much on parents and adults figuring this all out, but their little minds and hearts have to figure it out just as well. So I want to lift up the Scanlon family and lift up our kids today as we go to the Lord in prayer. So let's pray together. Father, I thank you for the songs that we have shared today. Even though some of us are thousands of miles away down in Florida, they're singing with their family here in Windham. And I got to say, praise the Lord for that gift. Even though we're miles apart here in Maine, we're singing together as a family here in Windham. So thank you, Lord, for technology and how it has been used to spread the gospel and to unite us as a family under God. Father, today I lift up the Scanlon family to you. Lord, I do thank you for the time that we had to fellowship with our sister Charlene. I thank you, Lord, for her diligence. The very first day she came here was on a work day, and she pitched right in, and she cleaned an entire garden by herself. And then she just began to allow you to weave her into the fabric of this fellowship more and more. And Lord, I watched her stand up on Sunday night and testify to how she has been sanctified unto the Lord, that she had given her life in sanctification to God, and that she wanted to do all that she could to draw nearer to him. And now, Father, she's with you. She has reached that moment of perfection that Paul talks about. And we thank you, Lord, that she is there. We thank you that we can celebrate the fact that if we choose to, we can see her again. But thank you, Lord, for the time that we had to share with our sister. Be with her family, I pray, Lord. Lord, today I lift up all of the children, not just of this church, but all of the children. Father, I pray that you would be with them as they try to sort through and figure out all that's going on. It's a sea change for everybody. We can process it as adults because we have the capacity to do so, but their little hearts and minds, they may not. So, Father, we pray that you would be with all of our children today. Father, would you let them know how much you love them? And Father, would you let them know how much we love them? Because we do. We love and we miss our babies. I can't wait till we're back together and we all get to see them and share around the table of fellowship again. Thank you, Lord, for all you do in our lives, how you watch over us, how you stand beside us no matter what we face. Now, Father, we come to you and we ask you to join us. Now let us join you in a deeper fashion as we break the bread of life. We pray this in Christ's name. And everybody said,
Amen. Amen.
This morning we'll be looking at the book of Jeremiah. If you want to turn there in your Bibles, the book of Jeremiah, chapter 29. Actually, my wife has built a slide and put it up there. Thank you, Anne Louise. She is my partner in ministry for, how many years have we been together now? 43 years we've been together. She's been my partner in ministry, and she has been a tremendous gift from God. What a blessing in my life. That's Jeremiah 29. And we'll go there in just a moment. But first, I want to read to you a psalm, Psalm 16:11. God will show me the path of life. God will show me the path of life. Do you believe that today?
Amen.
Do you believe that God will show you the path of life? And just to let you know, we have two parishioners with us today. We have Francis Lund and Steve Farron. They've come out and they're going to celebrate with us the gospel message. So I have to ask again, it says, God will show me the path of life. Do we believe that today? With all of the transitions that are going on, and the ways in which we can move around, do we still believe that it is God who is directing the paths of our lives? How are we accepting this path that He has us on? If it's all going well and there's no ups and downs to our everyday life, it's just everyday life, nothing big to deal with, then I believe that we can say, God will show me the path of life with great gusto. But what if the path God has us on is a little more trying? What if He places us, someplace that He has brought us to, and it doesn't fit with what we thought that path should look like? What if, like so many of our brothers and sisters around the world today, Christian men and women, what if we had to sneak around to fellowship together? And then if somebody was caught, somebody we love, and they were murdered for the sake of the gospel, could we still say, God will show me the path of life? If our paths, this path that He has us on, is a little demanding and a little stretching, what will we act like? This morning I would like us to look at a letter from a man of God that dealt with some of these very issues. He would write to God's people the counsel that God had for those people. Did you hear that? He would write to God's people the counsel that God had for those people. You need to hang on to that. God's in charge. Amen? Look at your neighbor and say amen. What Jeremiah wrote all those years ago was directly from God to God's men and God's women. The book of Jeremiah, as is all 66 books of the Bible, they are directly from the heart and mind of God. Did you hear that? These 66 books are directly from the heart and mind of God. They are, as we studied last week, God-breathed. I would like us to look at how most of the Hebrew nation in this story was led away to be held as captives by the world. The nation of God's people, most of them, would now have to live under rules and regulations of the heathens. God's people would have to learn how to stay God's people under a rule that took away a lot of their freedom, or most of their freedom. It was a rule that completely changed their lives, guidelines that completely altered how they used to live. Yet, God writes through Jeremiah to tell them that even though things have changed, they are still His people. Even though they may not want to be where they are, the path that He has taken them on is the path He has taken them on. It was not the heathen king. God used the heathen king to bring you to that path. But I want you to understand, my men and women, that it was me, your God, who has you standing on the path you're standing on today because it suits my will for your life. Did you hear that? The path that God has us standing on today is the path that He chose because it suits His will for our lives. Knowing all that, and knowing how things have changed these last few weeks, can we still say and agree with what the psalmist wrote, that God will show me the path of life? Would you stand today as we read from Jeremiah 29? Stand for the reading of God's word. We're going to pick it up at verse 4. The letter has been sent, and this is the contents of the letter. Verse 4. Thus saith the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, to all who were carried away captive, whom I have caused to be carried away from Jerusalem to Babylon. Build houses and live in them. Plant gardens and eat their fruit. Take wives and beget sons and daughters. And take wives for your sons and give your daughters to husbands, so that they may bear sons and daughters, that you may be increased there in captivity and not diminished. And seek the peace of the city where I have caused you to be carried away captive. And pray for the Lord for it. For it's in peace you will have peace. For thus saith the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, do not let your prophets and your diviners who are in your midst deceive you, nor listen to your dreams which you caused to be dreamed. For they prophesy falsely to you in my name. I have not sent them, saith the Lord. For thus saith the Lord, after 70 years, or a lifetime, if you have a different translation, After 70 years are completed at Babylon, I will visit you and perform my good word towards you and cause your return to this place. For I know the thoughts that I think towards you, saith the Lord, thoughts of peace and not of evil, to give you a future and a hope. Then you will call upon me and go and pray to me, and I will listen to you. And you will seek me and find me when you search me with your whole heart. I will be found by you, saith the Lord. Father, thank you for this word this morning. And we ask you, Father, to let it become life application to where we live. We pray, Lord, that you would open our hearts and minds. We've had a week, Lord. We've had a few weeks, and there's been some sea changes going on in our lives. And Lord, we're kind of angst, and we're kind of aggravated, and we're kind of upset. Some of us. Lord, would you help us put all that down? Just for the next 30 minutes. Help us sit down, all of us, to receive all of you. We pray this in Christ's name. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated. Now these are the words of the letter that Jeremiah the prophet sent from Jerusalem to the remainder of elders who were carried away captive. To the priests, the prophets, and all the people whom Nebuchadnezzar had carried away, the king, the queen, the princes of Judah, the craftsmen, the smithies, the carpenters, all had departed from Jerusalem. Within these two verses, we see a nation that was pretty much gutted. Gutted of the workforce of people. The tradesmen mentioned here, the craftsmen, the smithies, the carpenters, were all people who kept a society moving forward. I know that it mentions the priests, the prophets, and the royalty, but these leaders who were taken captive, these priests, prophets, and royalty, they were not leading very well. They had become so self-focused, and the ways of their worship to God had become so frugal and so weak that God had sent in a time of reminding. How the people listed here is important for us to understand. It's important to take note of. It lists the priests and prophets first, but actually in my studies, I found that Nebuchadnezzar actually went in first and took the tradesmen. He took captive the workforce, the craftsmen, the smithies, the carpenters. He went in first to take them because he wanted to remove them. And I thought, what a way to slow down society. To capture the workforce first. Tie up the workforce first. That's brilliant. If you want to slow down a society, take away the people that work for a living. Remove the ones who keep that society moving forward in a positive way. As I said, he took the tradesmen first. He did that because he thought they could make weapons of war against him. So Nebuchadnezzar goes in and he strips away the ones who work with their hands. And then he takes away the religious leaders. He removes the workers, and then he takes away the avenue of spiritual escape within the city. He takes away the priests and the prophets from God's city. And actually, I believe that was a thing, a moment or a movement by the enemy that God's going to use to strengthen them. I believe the enemy actually prompted him to go in and grab all the prophets and the priests and the diviners and bring them along with the captive crowd. I know that God is in control. But these priests and prophets that he grabbed out of the city to put in a group of captives were useless as all get out. They were terrible pastors. They've been giving poor counsel to the kings and to the people for a long time. And now with them captive, they're still going to be around the people. And it was going to get worse. In captivity, their counsel is going to be incapacitating to the people. That's why God warns them, don't seek them out. I touched on this a little bit last week. I mentioned that during times of captivity, during times of lockdown, during times of social distancing, there are going to be all kinds of prognosticators who come out of the woodwork thinking that they have all the answers we need to hear. They have thoughts and counsel on how we need to behave as we are on this path that God has placed us on. Now, these prophets were so bad that if you look at chapter 28, one of those prophets was so bad that God actually killed him. He was so poor in his pastoring that God took him out. It gives me the willies to think about that. I'm not going to be that guy. Somebody say amen. So along with the tradesmen, and the everyday folks. Nebuchadnezzar takes all these weak spiritual leaders. Doesn't that always help? Isn't that always such a big help to have spiritual influencers who are useless in a crowd where God is trying to do something brand new? They're such a big help. They bring all the negativity in. They bring all the problems in. They just keep stirring things up. God's trying to do a new thing. And these weak spiritual influencers, and they are around. You need to know that. The enemy has them everywhere. They're such a big help. Not. Of course, that's hyperbole. I'm being sarcastic. So he takes all these people, and then he writes this to them. Thus saith the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, to all who are captive, whom I, God, have caused to be carried away from Jerusalem to Babylon. We'll get to the details in a minute, but I want to address that opening line. I want us to see that it was God, who sent these instructions, and it was God who put them on this path of captivity. God. He's the one we look to when we are on the path that feels like captivity. Did you hear that? He's saying it, and he's so adamant about it because he's trying to get them to look to him in the midst of captivity. He said it 3 or 4 times in these few verses. It was me. Who am I? I've done this. You're there because I put you there. He's trying to get them to turn to him and focus to him in the midst of captivity. Look to him, not Facebook, not the news broadcasters, not even our nearest and dearest loved ones. Look to God first. Look to him and listen for what he would have us do as we are on that path of captivity. God. He's the author of this letter. And it's very important, it's muy importante, that you understand that God is the one that's orchestrating this. Accept the fact that outside of the obvious interference of the enemy towards our souls, that where we are standing right now is where God would have us to stand. If we are his, if we are living for him, it doesn't matter who is in control of society. Listen to me this morning. If we belong to God, if we are his 100%, Nebuchadnezzar thought he was in charge. It doesn't matter who's in charge of society. If we belong to God 100%, then he has a standing right where he has a standing. Amen? See, Jeremiah wants them to realize that it's by God's hand that we are headed where we are headed, boys and girls. Now, there's also a little consolation within that writing when he's talking to the captives. This letter had gone to the captives, not to those who remained in Jerusalem. And the captives were kind of thinking that they were bigger sinners, because they were captive, than those who had got to stay at the city. And God is kind of telling them, you've got to be able to look at the commentaries to find this, but God is kind of saying, no, it's for everybody. This path that you're on right now is for everybody. The people back in the city need this as bad as you need it who are in captivity. I need this change in their lives as much as I need it in your lives. But I want this group to be taken captive. Great impact later on. Read the rest of the Old Testament when they come back to restore the city and all the things that Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego and Daniel, all that stuff happened because God put them in the group of captives. And he left these guys back in the city. But they're all accountable for not worshiping God the way they should. All of you need to get on this path. All of you need to be refocused on me. For some, it's to be captives. For others, it's to remain in the city. And I'll tell you, the captives are actually going to have it a lot easier than those who remain in the city. Read Nehemiah. Read what those people that stay in the city go through. It is tremendous. So the letter takes away some of the blame in their hearts and minds, perhaps. It may have also given them a different mindset toward Nebuchadnezzar. Because he's going to call for us to make peace in captivity in a minute. So he's saying, I did this to you. You're here because I put you here. So it may have taken a little bit off of Nebuchadnezzar in their hearts and minds of those who were captive. Because they now know it was God who has done this. He has brought you to walk this path. He just happened to use the king to make it happen. He used leaders around you to make it happen. But he did it. Let me ask you a question. Can things get better on this path that we're on if we accept that the path we are on, God has placed us there? Can things get better if we accept the fact that where we stand is where God would have us to stand? Now, here's the secret to that. I said it a moment ago. If we are all His, all the time, and honestly living for Him, honestly worshiping Him, honestly seeking Him out, and not being spiritual meatheads, making wrong decisions by ourselves in our own mind, out of self, then we are His. He has led us to this path. Well, Pastor, live my life for the last few weeks. Pastor, live my life, and I bet you won't say that. Well, let me ask you this. Where you're standing right now, how did you get there? If you're outside of the will of God, how did you get to the place that you're standing right now? What were some of the choices that were made to create the path that we're standing on? Because if you're living for God, if we find ourselves living for God to the best of our ability, then we are on the path that He has chosen for us to be on. Now, since you're on that path, you're living for God, He has placed us there, we're accepting the fact that He has placed us there, then here it is, be still and know that He is God. If you belong to God, if you're living your life for Him, you're on the path that He has chosen for you, then right now, set down everything that's got you angst up this week about being in lockdown and be still and know that He is God. But if it's been our own poor choices in life, as I said, if we've been spiritual meatheads, and it's created that hot mess that we're living in, don't blame Him. You chose that path. The spiritual choices and the ways that we've been living are why God has taken them to this path of captivity. What they had chosen to do, is why they are in captivity. See, they were not worshiping God or living for God the way they knew they should be living for God. However, and this is key, they were still calling themselves sons and daughters of Jehovah, but it was hollow. They weren't living like men and women of God, but they were shouting that they were men and women of God. They were making a mockery of all the things He had given them. They were not living up to the potential of men and women of God that He knew they could be. And their spiritual lives weren't much different than the lives of the heathens around them. Yeah, they had titles and they knew all the songs and all the worship choruses, but they looked a lot like the guy down the street. What do our spiritual lives look like? We Christians of America, who have seen it so easy for the past two centuries, spiritually speaking, what does our worship to Jesus Christ and the Father look like? Is it anemic? Is it weak? Or do we really get up every day looking to praise and worship our Father? Do we think that perhaps we have walked the anemic path spiritually, and now these last few months, these last few weeks, we have been held captive by this tiny little virus because God is trying to get our attention? That perhaps He's trying to get His people to refocus on Him and His Son and not the amusements of the world? I don't know. But here we are. What are we going to do now? Well, God tells them what they should do now. Isn't God awesome? Tell your neighbor God's awesome. Look at your neighbor and say, God's awesome. He's awesome. He tells them that not only has He led them onto this path, but now that you're here, I'm going to give you the instructions, the perfect instructions, on how to behave on the path that I have you standing on. Did we hear that? That as we are in this life, this path, having been led there by God, that He will show us how to behave on that path. He's going to show them how to behave as they're in captivity. He will teach us how to live within whatever laws the unsaved may lay down. He's going to teach us how to live in whatever laws the unsaved may lay down. Now, don't run ahead of God. I see it all the time. People are already starting to build their rebellions. Don't run ahead of God. When it's time for Him to tell us to stand up, He'll tell us it's time to stand up. He will lead us there as well. Don't get so fired up about the loss of this or the loss of that we don't hear Him. God is very faithful to tell His people what to do when he wants us to do it. This is what he does here. He says, I have caused you to be carried away into Babylon. So, that's a big one. I have caused you to be carried away into captivity, into Babylon. So, here's his instructions on how to live in captivity. Build houses and live in them. Plant gardens and eat of their fruit. Take wives and beget sons and daughters. Take wives for yourselves and for your sons, so that they may bear sons and daughters too. Do these things so that you may increase while you're on this path, or in captivity, and not diminish. We'll get to the rest of God's instructions in a moment on how to live in lockdown. But I want us to look at these first directives from God. He tells these folks to build houses and live in them. Build houses and live in them. Well, what do we build a house for? Not to live in it, right? Well, let me ask you a question. How many here have ever been to a house and it's been just that, a house? It wasn't a home. We go in it and we feel absolutely zero feeling of family within those walls. I've been in many homes that were just that. They were houses. They were not a place to have life. Now the word live, build houses and live in them, that word live is what drives the obvious of what God is going to teach following the build houses. That word live is super important. Build houses and live in them. Because all who enter into that domicile that you build in my name, I want them to feel like they can take their shoes off and relax. He says, live in these houses. And I have to say, what better way to fill a house with life than by marrying someone? What a great beginning, huh? God says, take a wife, find a husband. Then as the two of you begin to build a house and make it a home, all of a sudden, bam, babies. You can figure that out for yourself. But you two fill this house with life. You see, there was a guy named Bob, and Bob was in captivity. He was in lockdown, and he was sitting around his house. He hadn't worked for a few weeks, and he was getting pretty bored. Suddenly, he felt the urge to go plant a garden. It just fell on him. He remembered he used to garden with his mom and dad when he was little. He was pretty good at it. So he goes out and begins to garden. Now, across the lot is this girl named Susan. That's his neighbor. She's captive too. She's in lockdown too. And she sees Bob out there toiling away. And she says, I've always wondered about that guy. Maybe I'll go over there and introduce myself to him and offer to help him with that hard work. So Susie goes over to meet Bob, both in lockdown, both in captivity. And right there, in the middle of captivity, amongst the dirt and the earthworms, they fall in love. These are directives from God. From this moment, in the middle of captivity, they find, here it is, life. They find life. They listened to what the man of God had written down in his letter. They stopped all the fussing and complaining about being captive, what they could do and could no longer do, and they went back to living. They put their hands to what they knew they could put their hands to. They stopped all the complaining about what they could do and what they could not do, and they trusted in God that he had them on this path of captivity. And then if they would go back to living for him, like they'd been taught when they were kids, they would indeed find life in life more abundantly, even in captivity. Right there, in the middle of captivity, he would come into their home. Life would come into their home. Now, from this meeting of Bob and Susie, a wedding took place. And then babies took place. And then the babies grew up, and more weddings took place. And then pretty soon there was grandchildren and great-grandchildren. And the numbers began to grow like wildfire. All because Bob and Susie took the chance to stop focusing on their captivity and live a life under God's guidance on that path. Now, Bob and Susie's family is massive. Man, talk about increase and not diminish. That's what God said. Remember what he said? I want you to increase and not diminish. Bob and Susie ended up with 11 children, 27 grandchildren, and 35 great-grandchildren. They began to outnumber their captors. I think God's got something in mind here. You remember when Moses released the Hebrews into the Promised Land? That's in Deuteronomy 6. He told them about the law of God again. He reiterated the law of God. He told them to be fruitful and multiply. Paraphrasing. And he said, as you have all those kids, teach them about God. See, that's what he's trying to do here. God's trying to get Jeremiah to tell the people to start having kids so they would increase, not diminish. And as you grow those kids and families, tell them about God. Moses said, as you grow these families, as you have all these babies, would you teach them how to live for God and not the world? Do we do that? Do we teach our children how to live for God and not the world? With all the stuff that inundates their lives every single day, what are we doing to counteract that? I don't want to say counterbalance it, because that's not a good word. Counteract. Stop it from happening. He said, tell them about God. Tell your kids about God. Teach them about God when they get up. Tell them how awesome God is when they get up. First thing in the morning, at the breakfast table, say, man, kids, God is awesome. Have them say it back to you. As a good psalm says, God is good all the time, because all the time,
God is good.
God is good. He said, teach them at the breakfast table. When you get them up, tell them God's awesome. Then when you send them off to school and you put them on the bus, tell them God is awesome. He's going to watch over you at school today, Timmy. God is awesome. When you pick them up and it's time for supper and you're sitting around as a family, tell them God is awesome. And then this is a big one. When you tuck them in at night, the last thing I want them to hear, the first thing they heard and the last thing they're going to hear is you tell them, Dad, how awesome God is. You tell them, Mom, how awesome God is. Tell them how much, Dad and Mom, you love the Lord your God. On the path that you're standing on right now, today, look at your children and tell them, in spite of all that's transpiring in our society, tell them how awesome God is to you in your life. On the path he has you on right now. Jeremiah's letter from God told the captives to start building a house. And when it's all said and done, and you have this awesome family surrounding you, it will be a home. Teach them as they grow up about this awesome God, will you, Dad? And maybe, Dad, as you're sitting around after a good meal, tell them how you all happened to wind up in this place, this captivity. Maybe, Dad, tell them that it was a severe lack of love and regard and honest worship towards God and his ways. It was a sloppy spiritual life that God used to lead you to where you're standing right now so that you can celebrate again how awesome God is. Maybe, Mom, you could tell them that where you stand right now in captivity, it was God's design for you all to be there. Captivity, yet still a family. Captivity, yet God still rules. And he goes on, God goes on through Jeremiah. That was building the house and growing a family. And he says also, seek peace of the city where I have caused you to be carried away captive. He's saying it again. And pray to the Lord of hosts for it. Seek peace of the city where I have caused you to be carried away captive. And pray to the Lord of hosts for it. For it's in peace, you will have peace. Man, I bet that was a tough one to do. I bet that was a tough one to do. God is telling the men and women who claim him as their God to pray for the ones who have taken you captive. Make peace with them. Well, that's tough, God. That's really tough, God. Do you know, God, that I have to wear a face mask just to go into the store? That I have to limit myself to one bag of flour and one bag of sugar? That I can't sit with my brothers and sisters at fellowship? Really, God? You want me to pray for those people who have done this? Why? He says, seek out peace. This is what the word seek means. Now listen to me. Think about where we are today. It means to attain and to find by any means or any methods. Peace. To attain and find by any means and any methods. This means, first and foremost, he said this, you're going to have to go to your God in prayer. The guy who took you into captivity, you're now going to have to go to him and ask him to give you the wisdom to bring peace to where you stand. Go to God in prayer. Seek out his peace or his wisdom for the peace that he's calling for us to make. He's asking them, as they're on this path that he has led them on, to seek out, find it any way you can, this peace. For those of us who serve God, as I said, it's going to be through prayer. See, this is where we always find the ways and means to anything he asks us to do. In this case, he's talking about peace. But we're going to find whatever we need through prayer to God. Seek out this peace and pray to the Lord for it. And in this peace, you will have peace. It'll be a peace that passeth your understanding. I'm adding that for emphasis. You ever been in a situation where you prayed for God's peace and all of a sudden it fell on you and you're going, wow, how did that happen? It's a peace that passeth our understanding. Same peace here. I'm going to bring you that peace in the midst of your captivity. You're not going to know what's going on, but would you please just live in it? It passes your understanding. You aren't going to be able to figure it out. Don't try to figure it out. Just live in it. We'll be in the middle of captivity. God's peace will reign supreme in our lives, in those homes where all the babies are. And all around us, God's peace will fall on the saved and the unsaved. Do you believe that this morning? God's peace can fall on the saved and the unsaved. It's called the wooing of the Holy Spirit. Have you ever worked with a group of people, and there's always one guy or one gal, usually the foreman, who set the tone for the workday? And sometimes it's people that you don't want to be around. They seem to be the ones who always brought down the wrath and that feeling of tension all the time on the job site. Now God's asking you to go up to that person and make peace with them. Befriend them. Now, you do. It's a little weird at first, but you go up. You've gone to God. You prayed about it. And you go up to make peace with that guy. He doesn't know Jesus like you know Jesus, but God's telling you to go befriend him. That's what's happening here. Go befriend that guy that can bring down the tension on the job site like that. Go make peace with him. So I prayed about it, and we went and made peace, and I became his friend. A little weird at first. He kind of rejected my offer of friendship. But as time went on, that hard spirit began to wear away, and God began to let him see himself in me. And then you begin to seek out that peace at a higher level that God taught us to seek out. Pretty soon, the job site becomes better, now here it is, for everyone. Not just the Christians, but those who get to find Jesus. That foreman who was so hard to reach was reached by the peace of God. Now all who work for him have peace. And it's a lot nicer place to be. He said, seek peace and you'll have peace. True story, by the way. Have we, in the midst of all the changes that have come about, have we sought out God's peace through prayer? Have we prayed for our leaders? Or have we joined with some rabble-rousers who only want to stir things up and cause more discontentment and more anger? And I see these posts all the time, and they drive me insane. Are we seeking God's wisdom? Are we seeking to make peace? Or are we becoming rabble-rousers? Well, Pastor Sam, they're taking our freedoms away, life and liberty and the pursuit of happiness. Let me tell you something. God will give you that when it's his time. He's called you on this path. He's called us on this path. He will give us what we need as he knows we need it. I want you to think back to some brothers that were taken in this whole big captivity thing. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. They're on this path. They're part of this letter. And they walked a path where they couldn't say anything. Right up to the fire pit. The only thing they said is that we are not careful as to how we answer you, O king. Meaning we're not going to bow down. We are not careful as to how we answer you, O king. And at that point, he wrapped them up in rope from the tip of their toes to the top of their hats, and he threw them in the fire, still on the path, still believing in God, not resisting, not rebelling, not running away from the fire pit, standing where God called them to stand. Right in the midst of the fire, they find Jesus. We don't need to worry about when we're supposed to stand up. We don't need to worry about somebody calling us to arms. When it's time for us to do something different than what God has right now, he'll show us. In the meantime, seek peace to have peace. God will show me the path of life. You still believe that? You still believe that God will show us the path of life? See, God's word has taught us that if we claim to be his, He will lead us to the path of life, the one that he wants us to stand on. It'll be his hands that guide us to stand wherever it is that he needs us to stand and be his men and women on that path. Jeremiah was writing God's letter to these captives to try to help them receive this fact that God brought them there. And he was teaching them in the process, God was, the ways in which they would not only survive captivity, but they would flourish and they would increase within it. God tells them no matter where it is, he has us standing. Whatever path of life we may be on today, or to build homes, in other words, or to live life, or to keep talking to our children about how awesome God is, or to keep worshiping him honestly, not anemically, not weak, but honestly worship God right where we are. And fill at home with his praise, fill at home with his worship, and find out about the ways of God. How can we worship him better? No matter where it is we may be, no matter what path he has us standing on today, good or tough, could we seek his love and his peace and let it not only be found within our homes, but found wherever we go. Seek peace and you will have peace. We're going to continue next week with further instructions on how we are to live on the path that God has us on. And it gets very exciting because we're going to really honestly begin to seek out God, and he will be found. But today the question is, will we obey what his word has told us to do as we stand on the path that he has led us to? Let's pray together. Father, I thank you again for your words through Jeremiah to your people. Your words to us today, all these thousands of years later, these words still ring with honesty and truth. They're still as applicable now as they were when you had Jeremiah write them down. Father, I pray for all of us today. I pray for those listening at home. Lord, this has been a heavy sermon for me to write and to study this week. It's so applicable to where we're living right now. There are so many that are struggling under what they think is the yoke of bondage. But Lord, if we claim to be yours, if we live honestly for you, then where we stand is where you want us to stand right now. If there's anything different, you'd have brought us there. But Lord, as we stand today on this path, could we seek your wisdom? Could we seek your peace? Could we, Lord, as you said, build homes to live in? In other words, could we put our hands to what you place in front of us? If it's to go out and do a garden, Lord, let us put our hands to that. If it's to go out and build a couple benches and a fire pit, let us put our hands to that. If it's to send cards and make calls, Lord, let us do that. Let us put our hands to build houses and not sit around bellyaching about what we can't do. There's so many things that we can do in your name. So, Father, today I pray these words from Jeremiah, or from you through Jeremiah, would settle into our spirits, and we would look at the week ahead with a whole new understanding that God is in control. You got this, God. And when you tell us it's time to do something different, we'll know it's you, because we've been listening right now. Thanks again, Lord, for the broken bread. Thank you for the fellowship of this church family. And I ask you to be with all those who have watched today. Bless their lives, Lord, in a big, big fashion. I pray that the hand of God would rest upon them in such a way that they would know, without a doubt, our God reigns. And we pray this in Christ's magnificent name. Amen. God bless you guys, and I'll see you tomorrow at Devotions. Love you.